Hello explorers and welcome to another video. Today is the third installment in the TensorFlow object detection series that we're doing here. And this part three is going to be about training, and it's going to be about local training. We'll start there. So if you have a machine at home that is pretty good and you can do some inference and training on it, then you can do this locally. But in order to do that, you need to install some stuff. So we are going to start with that, to install the dependencies we need to actually run this. So here we have some dependencies listed. We have protobuf, and that's Google's library to make a configuration and read configuration. So it's a standardless way of writing and reading configurations. Then we need Python TK, and that's also a language extension to Python. Pillow, I think that's a image library, I don't know. LXML is pretty much reading XML files, I guess. TFSlim, and it should be included here, so it's not something that we need. Jupyter Notebook, I'm not really sure if you need that, because I'm not using any notebooks in my examples here. Maybe they have some internal code that requires it. I'm not sure if you need it for training. Matplotlib, that's a lib from MATLAB that you actually can do some calculations and so on, so that's required. TensorFlow, of course. Cython, so you have a connection to C libraries. ContextLib, don't know what that is. And the COCOA API, and that's to read the COCOA training files and do evaluation on those. So first off, we install TensorFlow. You can either install the pure TensorFlow for CPUs or the one for GPUs. If you install the one for GPUs via a pip package, it will tell you to actually set your path so you have the CUDA libraries in your path. Because TensorFlow GPU, at least in my installation, uses CUDA, and in the latest 1.8.0, they are requiring CUDA 9.0, and then you also need to install CUDA NN 7.0. So I installed those in a directory, and then I pointed my path to that CUDA directory slash bin, so it could find all the libraries. And then you can use this GPU. I have a long-running series where I'm trying to build TensorFlow so you can build it from the latest source with some CUDA library to get a good compilation there. And I haven't been able to do that yet, but you can actually set it up just by installing the pip packages. So that's interesting. And I'm using Windows with MSys 2. So this is everything is for Windows at the moment. But I have ran this in Linux. So I've used at home my Debian installation that I multiple boot by. And I also use it at work in my Gentoo installation, and it works fine in both those. And I believe it's easier to install on Linux and get it running on Linux than on Windows. So this should apply to Linux as well. If you're using Ubuntu, you have a quick command here to install protobuf and everything like that. And in Windows, I used all the pip packages, so I installed all of these. Like these commands here. Then I needed the COCOA API installation. And this was a little bit interesting, because first off, I got a Git repository, and I tried to do make in that Git repository, but it wasn't able to actually do make, because it sets some extra flags that is not available in Windows. So I will show you that. So here inside of the setup Py, inside of this Python API library, you have some extra compile arguments here, and if you comment those out, they will build in Windows, and you will get a directory called COCOA tooling, as it says in this installation here. PyCoco tools. And that directory you then copy over to models research, and in that directory, this directory should be located in order to actually do this evaluation. I'm not doing any evaluation on this COCOA metrics, so I haven't actually tried it, but I think it should work fine. It installs, it builds fine, so it should work. And then you need to compile their protobuf files, the configuration files. And this command is the one that you run. But in Windows, you have one little headache that this protobuf or protoseal binary is actually not installed in the protobuf package if you install protobuf via the Pacman system that you use in MSys2. So in order to get protobuf library or the protobuf executable, I actually just went to the release page of protobuf, and here under the release of protobuf first 3.6.0, I found this protobuf C Windows binaries. So I downloaded that zip package, opened it up, put it in a location, and then used that binary to compile my protobufs, or convert my protobufs. And then in MSys2, you export a Python path and add the current directory, this research directory, and also slim, so Python knows about the extra libraries in this models research directory. And after you've done that, you run this Python script, and it will actually output some interesting information. You can actually run it. It's quite fast. And when you run this, you will get some status information that will tell you if you were able to actually install everything and get it up and running. And here we have it. You see, I run this tooling, and it gives an error up here that something is deprecated, but that doesn't matter. And then when it's done with that, it actually tells it ran 15 tests and all 15 tests were okay. So now you know that you have a system up and running. And as you see up here, I have actually been running my training for a bit. So this is the command that I ran for training. I run Python in the object detection. I run the training Python script. I want my errors to log out to standard error. So log to standard error, as this flag says. And then I need this pipeline configuration path. So I tell it where is my configuration for my model. And this is the path in my home directory. So it's in C colon, GitHub, RCNN model, test, Waldo model config. And then I also tell it where my training directory is. And that's everything that is needed to actually run training. So it took a while to get it started. So in Linux, I believe it's actually quite fast to get it up and running. But in Windows, it takes some time for it to actually accelerate up and actually get to doing the actual training. I'm not sure if it's a lot of libraries it needs to read, or if I have a slow disk on my computer, or what it is. But it took a while, let's say 3-4 minutes for it to actually start training. But as you see here, the training steps is around half a second, and I believe in Linux it was around 0.3 or something. So it's a bit slower in Windows, but it's not that much slower. So you can use this in Windows, but a dedicated Linux machine with all the drivers and so on will be a bit faster, I believe, still. And so that was the command. So let's look at The training configuration, we looked at that last time. The only thing to note in the training configuration today is when you are training in Windows, you use the MCS paths in your command line, but in your config you need to actually put in /. Because it will not find your files if you are using the MCS notation. When you are running this training, you can also get to a point where it tells you that the shape of your training is a wrong shape. It should be a list of things, but you actually get just a number. And that's a little problem you have in Python 3 that you don't have in Python 2, because they are a little bit different. And in this case, they have actually not built this training model in a Python 3 way. It works fine in Python 2, but if you are running into this problem, you can go into this Learning Schedules Python. So that's inside of your models directory, research, and then you go into the object detection and utils, and in this utils you have learning schedule.py, and at the bottom of this file it actually is just like this: reduce, max, where, and so on. And here where you see range, you add list. So you force that to be a list of numbers, and that will work in Python 3 as well. So that's a little gotcha. I hope that they fix it in the actually source Git repository, but there is a lot of people talking about this issue on their issue board, so they are aware of it, but I haven't seen they actually updating the files. So that was how to run training. You can also evaluate your model. That's pretty much the same. You tell it where to that you want the standard error, the errors to the standard error. Your pipeline configuration checkpoint there, that's your training directory. So that's the directory we told it to put your output data into when you were training. And then you want to give it an evaluation output there, where it will put the logs from the evaluation. So that's how you run evaluation on your model. Next up we have the tensor board. So this is how you look into your module when you are training it. And that's just telling it where your output dir is, so your training output dir, and it will give you a view into that and tell you things about your model. And if you are running it during training, you can also see the value change, and you can get some histograms and so on. So that's quite interesting to look at when you are running your training of your model. So this was what I wanted to cover today about training your model locally. I hope that you found this interesting. I hope that I covered some of the gotchas that you might run into if you are trying to train this model yourself. If you have any questions at all about this approach or anything else, then leave them in the comment section below. If you like this episode, give it a like, share it with your friends and colleagues. If you haven't subscribed yet and want to know when the next episode comes out, then please subscribe. And I really hope to see you in the next video.